So thanks for everyone coming, and we do have another 9 people who've asked to have this recorded so that they can view this later. And it's wonderful to see so many people who are keen to have a bit of an update, especially as we onboard Kira into the space of helping us with clearances. But I'd just like to say that we really value the work that our parish safe ministry officers do. It's wonderful. Years ago, we used to have parishes with filing cabinets full of documents and a registry full of filing cabinets full of documents, and the left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing. And we've gone a long way to resolving those silos of information not talking to each other through the platform we have of Safe Ministry Online. But it's not perfect, and we're still continuing to unpack the way that we can work together to, in this important part of ministry, which is making sure that places of worship and our places of ministry activity are safe places for all. And I know a lot of people feel it's an incredible administrative burden, but I've always seen it as not so much as a burden, but an offering that we can contribute to our ministry. If through our actions we can help keep the vulnerable people safe in our churches and our ministry activities, then our efforts are worthwhile. So enough for me. I'd like to introduce, so I've got a few people here in the room, and maybe I'll introduce myself, Richard Connolly, Registrar for the Diocese, and I might get us to go around and we can each introduce ourselves and with a bit of an introduction as to our role in the Safe Ministry place. Alex, do you want to take it off?
Okay. Good morning. My name is Alice Weatherall. I'm the SNO at Moe Newborough, also on the SMA committee, as many other things.
So what does SMA stand for?
Safe Ministry Authority.
Great.
And, yeah, that's about it.
Hi, everyone. My name is Marcella. I'm from Piura. I do a lot of the clearance information, so really what we're talking about today for Kiura. I've worked there for nearly 6 years, as long as we've been around, and I do a lot of work with other dioceses with their clearance process as well. And I've been working with beautiful Alice, who has been wonderful in keeping me up to date, and as we come on board, just sort of touching base about what's done and what's not done and things like that. So we're getting there.
Hello, my name is Katrina Thomas. I'm the Director of Professional Standards at Kiura. Obviously, my part in clearances is when there may be an issue that arises or something that needs to be looked into a bit further and may need to be some questions asked or some further inquiries made. Maybe something might need to go to the Professional Standards Committee around any clearance issues. The person who you would most be speaking to is going to be Julie Riley, who is connected on Zoom today. So Julie will no doubt introduce herself. She's the deputy director appointed to Gippsland Diocese.
My name is David Herring. I'm the Bishop's Chaplain here at the Registry and Priest in Charge of Stratford, but mostly here at the Registry, kind of fingers in a few different pies, kind of help out with our on our Safe Ministry Authority. I've been a taker and secretary to some degree. You'll see me regularly updating stuff on the website, and also generally I'm the go-to person for dealing with SMO issues.
I'm Val Jones. I think I know everyone on screen. Kath Connolly, are you actually there?
Yes, I'm here.
Why aren't we allowed? Oh, so you're here. Sorry, Kath Grandy, are you actually there?
Yeah.
No. Yes, I'm here.
Oh, Holly's there. Can
I
have her speak?
Okay. Thank you. Okay. All right. I'm Val Jones, and I chair the Safe Ministry Authority.
Hi, everyone. I'm Christine Angus, and I'm here today, one, because I'm interested, but also our safe ministry officer from the parish where I am at St Thomas's in Bunyip is overseas at the moment, so I'm actually representing Ruth Ruth Green.
Yeah.
But looking forward to today very much.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone. I'm just going to take over the chairing now, and I'm going to jump back a little bit. In accordance with the Child Safe Standards, I begin by acknowledging the traditional caretakers of this land, the Kurnai Gano people, and I pay my respects to their elders, emerging, current, and in the past. And I've asked Dave Perryman to do a very short prayer to get us started.
Loving Lord, we do give you thanks for the hearts and minds gathered here, indeed gathered in spirit, or indeed later on. Lord, we pray that your wisdom and your insight would flow this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Okay, I'm going to give a bit of background and then turn over to the people who are actually doing the work here. So last year we lost two people retired. Brenda Alford retired as our clearance officer, and so did Cheryl Russell retire as our Director of Professional Standards. Now, in order for the diocese to replace, or I guess the work that those two were doing, they have engaged Kiura to do this, to help us do this. Now, in a minute, I'm going to pass over to Kiura staff and they might give you a bit of background on Kiura. But if we break it into two separate things, the first thing is professional standards. Now, most safe ministry officers don't have a lot to do with professional standards. However, it's really good that you know what's going on in this space. So when Cheryl Russell left, the professional standards community or committee wanted to ensure that the committee stayed based in Gippsland. And we're really pleased that Julie Riley was appointed the Director of Professional Standards for Gippsland. And she is a Gippslander. So I'm going to very quickly pass over to Julie. I don't know whether Katrina wanted to say anything as well, but I want, Julie will introduce herself and then tell you what her job is. For safe ministry officers, the thing to be mindful of here is that this is where you direct complaints, or this is where you direct queries about church safety issues. So, Julie. Or is Katrina?
Julie, you're on mute, I think.
No, I've just taken myself off.
Okay.
Hello, everybody. Yes, I am Julie Riley, and I do live in Gippsland. So I think, Val, you've summed it up quite well in your short prose. So I am the Deputy Director of Professional Standards for Kiura, but am looking after all of the Gippsland Diocese. So as you said, any complaints would be directed to myself, which I would then look into and present to the PSC, Professional Standards Committee, for a decision to be made as to how we should move forward in relation to those complaints. In relation to clearances and anything like that, they would be directed to Marcella, not myself. We've sort of had a little bit of teething issues where I was getting quite a few calls in relation to that. So, but I would just forward those on to Marcella. So I report to Katrina, who is sitting in the room. So if I'm not sure about something, or I would go through Katrina, but I will be presenting to the PSC. I don't know if there's anything else I need to say, Katrina.
No, I think you've covered it, Julie. It's really, if a clearance everything's straightforward. It really, everything just goes through Marcella. Any of those general inquiries in relation to clearance, what might be required, where do I send it to, that sort of thing, all through Marcella. But any of those more tricky issues that might come up through a CRIM check or a referee check or a complaint, then that's when Julie would become involved and there might be some consultation between the two of us. But she's your person in Gippsland, so please reach out to her if there are any tricky situations or complaints that come about.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so to contact Julie, you're in Kiura, and as we say in the training, where do you find the number? Well, it's usually behind the toilet door. And when I visit parishes, it's the first thing I check is that the sign is up about professional standards and where you ring. It's
I thought you had a bowel issue.
No. Well, I'll tell you about that later. So it's a 1-800 number, 1-800-135-246. But as I say, you'll find it on all the posters. And Julie, can you just walk us through what happens when someone rings that number?
So there's intake personnel at Kiura that will speak to the person and get a brief, try and get as much details as possible for us in relation to what the complaint might be. Once they've got all of that details, it's entered into our system, our LEX system, and then we have if it's urgent, I'd be contacted straight away. I just wanted to point out to everybody that I am only casual, so I usually work 3 days a week, so Monday, Tuesdays and Thursdays, just for people's... but if it's urgent and I'm not there, Katrina would be notified and then we would follow up. If it's not, we have a matters review meeting every Thursday. And during that meeting, we discuss intakes that have come in. So then they would be allocated and followed up from there.
Thank you, Julie, and welcome to Gippsland.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we're now going to move to the other role that Kiura has, and this is the one that's more relevant to safe ministry officers. So we're going to talk about compliance. Now, from here on out, if you have questions, I'd like you to ask them as we go along. So just use the pretty little picture of the hand and we'll do that. Because the process that we've been using is changing and it's really important that you understand the changes. We are hoping that they will lessen the load for people in parishes. But I'm going to pass over to Marcella, who will introduce and tell us about what she does and step us through the new process. The other person who's important in this is Alice Weatherall over here, pretty in pink. Alice is the SMO for Moe Newbra, but she's been using the new process. So she can give us some hands-on feedback about it. So, Marcella.
Okay. We're just doing some technological stuff. Well, while we're waiting for that, just a couple of things. So as I said, we took over, was it towards the end of last year, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And I think there'd been a bit of a gap between the previous people who are working and then us taking on. So I suppose an issue that we've had is that a lot of people had started applications after Brenda or Cheryl or while they were there but hadn't been completed when we started. So we've had a bit of an issue to know who's actually applying for a clearance and who's not. So we've been given access to SMO, which has been great, and we've been going in there to see things, but there's actually over 1,100 entries in SMO. So unless we went into every single one, we actually wouldn't know what the status is of each one.
Can I jump in there?
Yeah.
That because people from Kiura have been accessing Safe Ministry online, They've put themselves in as members of parishes. So if you see Marcella's name, for instance, you'll know that she's not in, in your parish, but she's accessing your data. Okay, sorry. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I think they did that when they set us up.
Yeah.
So they put Gail and me in there, and maybe even Michelle, because people were saying, who are these people that have come into the parish? I think it's so that it enables us to be able to go in and see your parish's information.
That should be sorted now.
Yeah, oh, is it? Okay. Yeah, no, that's all good. Yeah, so I suppose we've done a bit of discussion with Alice and Val about what's required. I might just go when I'm just going to get straight to our front page here. So I suppose the first thing we wanted to do was to clear up what the way we're using SMO is. We're gaining as much information about an application from SMO. So say, for example, when we're alerted to someone requiring a clearance, the first thing we do is we go into SMO. We'll look at their working with children card number. We'll see if there's been a police check done. And then we can use all of those things for the application. What we, there's other checks that we do that aren't on SMO. So we then do those other checks as well. And then when we've got all the information that we need, we'll email the parish SMO a certificate to say that they've got a clearance from Kiura. So in discussions with Alice, you know, I was sort of saying our problem is we don't know who's, because people were saying, we applied ages ago and we haven't heard, but there's so many, because there's so many people in SMO, we don't know that you've applied. So the way this system that we've generated is really to enable us to be alerted that someone is applying for a clearance, and then we can start processing it. Richard, did you have a question?
And I'm just going to jump in there and say, so that brings to just to remind you, that is why we emailed all our parishes recently to ask for an updated list of who all your current church workers are in the parish, to help Kiura understand which clearances they needed to prioritise, and also to double check to make sure that they were all current and complete. So that process is still happening and we're still working through that.
So if you haven't sent the form back, if you could, that would be great. So it just gives us an idea, because when we said we could go through all 1,100, but it's going to take a lot of time and a lot of those people may not be volunteering anymore, so it's not worth the time. So this is how we sort of worked out a process of what's required and how we go about it. So if we have a look here, half of the thing's gone on there. Okay, so there was a bit of ambiguity about who needed what for a clearance. And unfortunately, only half of my table has come out on the slide, but I can talk through the other things. So in a parish, there's basically three levels of clearances that are required. There's a clearance for a lay reader, which is actually the same as a clergy clearance. There's an authorised church worker, which are the people who volunteer at your church. And then you've got your op shop volunteers. So we thought it'd be easy if we put it into a table of who needs what, so that then you know exactly what someone is required to have. So a lay reader needs the safe ministry check for clergy and lay. They also need a police check, working with children check, signed code of conduct, and to have attended professional standards training. So or you'll get a handout with all of these things on it with the ones that's missed out on the table. So for authorised church workers, so someone who's doing some work at your church, they don't do the safe ministry check for clergy or lay, but they do the volunteer check, which is much shorter and much less onerous. They need a police check, a working with children check, the signed code of conduct, and to have attended professional standards training. Yeah, so when I talk about the references, the safe ministry check includes us then doing the referee checks. So I think originally the safe ministry officers used to get the safe ministry check in and then they would have to do the two referee checks. Now the form will come directly back to us and we will do those two referee checks. So I'll talk about that a bit more in the process, but this SMO doesn't need to worry about having to do that anymore.
I think Tracy's put her hand up. And you're on mute, Tracy.
Yeah, sorry about that. I'm in my office and I don't have all my usual cleverly set up camera and everything like that. I was wondering, I did a referee check for a lay reader in our parish last week, and the reference check it was very, 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 very thorough. And I just wanted to ask, I'm assuming that it's not the same reference check, not the same set of questions that you would ask someone who is
So what you did last week, Tracy, was for the lay reader, which is the same as the clergy. Yeah. The reference check that we do for the authorised church worker is about 10 questions, or not even that, yes, no, far simpler. Because that clergy, that one that you filled in last week, Tracy, was a general synod referee form for, and that, as I say, that's for clergy and lay.
Okay.
So volunteers are much simpler than that.
All right.
And then the final one we've got is the op shop volunteer. So they don't need to fill in any of the safe ministry check forms, but they need a police check, a working with children check, and to sign the code of conduct. And they don't need training. So what we've done is we've put the code of conduct and the safe ministry check together. So it's just one form that you give people to fill in, just so that it's sort of less things that you need to do. Okay, so I'll go through the three different types. In terms of SMO, for a lay reader, all you need to do is let us know that you have a lay reader in your parish who requires a clearance and send us an email with their email address on it. What we'll do is then email the lay reader, we'll send them the links to everything and the form that they need to fill in and give them all the instructions. We'll process it and then it'll come back to the diocese. So you don't need to do anything else in the clearance for a lay reader. We'll organise all that ourselves. So the second one, the next one is an authorised church worker. So when we were talking about this, with Alice and some of the other people on the SMA, there was a worry that because the forms are on the website and there's an opportunity, what was happening was some people were applying for a clearance when they hadn't actually been given a role in a church. So Alice developed a notification of application form. So basically it's a form that says, this is the name of the person, this is the role that they're applying. The member of clergy in the parish signs it to say they approve the application. And then if you send that form to us, we know straight away that we need to look out for clearance information for this person. So that's the first step. The next thing that the SMO would do would be either to add or update that applicant in SMO. We found when we went into SMO, and I understand, you know, different parishes have people with different levels of computer abilities, but sometimes there's just a name there, but there's no role, there's not. So we really don't know what they're applying for or any other information. So if you can update what the role is in there, that would be great, because if it's a op shop volunteer, it's going to be obviously different to what we're looking for than it is if they're a church worker. Then you give the applicant a safe ministry check, which I've got copies of for everybody here, and I'll also email them. They'll be emailed out to all the SMOs. And attached to that is the code of conduct. So they fill in the safe ministry check and then they send it back to us directly. The reason that it's sent back to us directly is because often there's information on it that people might be required to provide, but they don't really want to provide it back to the parish. That they might feel that, you know, that's something that it's have something that's happened in their past, but they don't want people to know about it. It's something that we can look at. So if we get something back in, Julie or Katrina, we'll have a look at it. I'll say, oh, this person has written this in their form. They'll have a look at it and they'll say, yeah, that's okay. I might just give them a ring and have a chat about it or whatever. So the reason that it comes back to us is so that they can provide that confidential information without it going back to the parish with, you know, the risk of other people finding out that information that they may were not wanting to divulge. And as I say, often it's information that doesn't affect a clearance anyway, but it's just
to keep things confidential. So the safe ministry check, the details of where to send it back to are on the information that you've got here, and it's also on the form for the applicant. And then the police check. So we now have access to PRIM check. So the SMO provides the link to police check portal and assistance to the person if they need it in applying for a police check. So what happens is that the applicant fills in their part of the police check, which is fairly simple. It's names, previous addresses in the last 5 years, and then they have to upload some identity documents. In CRIM check now, there's two ways that you, well, probably three ways that you can do the identity documents. The most secure way would be to upload it directly into the application. So you now need four items of ID, which has been, I think, over the last couple of years,
It's been for a while.
Yeah. So the easiest ones that we find for people are a current passport, driver's license, working with children card, and Medicare card. They're normally the easiest ones for people to get. Otherwise, there might be a full birth certificate if people haven't got a passport. There are other combinations of ID documents that are listed on the website. So once the person does their police check application and uploads their ID, we then log in to PRIM check from our end. We check that the ID matches the information that's been provided in the check, and then we lodge the check. If you don't feel capable of uploading documents and things, if that's a bit tricky, you can either email those documents to us, you can sometimes people post them, or you might be able to speak to Alice at the diocese, and if she can see the ID documents, she can, because you can also lodge police checks.
Dave can, and so can Richard Connolly.
So Val, are you somewhere in this area, or are you?
I live in Traralgon South.
Okay.
But quite often I organise to go and talk to particularly op shop people, and I can do their CRIM check on the spot, and it's usually back in 10 minutes.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, so if there are people around if you're having difficulty with the ID document part of it. So when the police check is done, you can then a copy of the check is sent to the applicant via into the email address that they did it. So it's always handy for you to keep a copy of for the applicant to keep a copy of that in case they need it for something else. So that's the police check. We will lodge it. We can see when it comes back. We add those details into SMO and into our system. So we'll deal with that. Check applicant has working with children card, and if not, provide the link to obtain one and perhaps assist them if needed. Working with children applications are different to police checks in that working with children only allow the applicant to go into the application and do anything with it. So you can't sort of ring us up and say, oh, something's happened with my working with children card, because they won't let us go in or even ask questions about it. So it's good if the SMOs might be able to assist with any issues with the working with children check. You don't get a lot, but just sometimes there are little things that, for example, the working with children check, when you did it, you've got a new email address, so you didn't get the renewal email or something like that. So if the SMO can help with those parts, but because you actually have to be, it's all done by a link and a password that to enable you to actually get in and make changes to the account.
Are you still able to do those through the post office? But given the age group of a lot of your parishioners who don't have computer skills, you can
do they still let you go into the post office and do that? Even with the form?
Yeah. Well, all you've got to say is they say, can you download your identity thing? You say no, and then it takes you to another link. And the link will say, do you want to do this to a post office outlet? And say yes, and it just happens. And then you get that little certificate that you that you take to the post office with your driver's license.
However, not all post offices are authorised to do them.
Yeah,
so
that's right. And some require an appointment and things to go. Yeah. But you still need to do the initial part online,
yes,
don't
all
you?
Yes, all of it's online.
Yeah, it's just the identity document part of it that you can do at the post office.
Won't they listing an organisation for one that might for notifying or suspension?
Yeah, I think they're putting the Anglican Diocese of Gippsland as their organisation, aren't they? Because
they
their letters come here.
Yes, they do.
Yeah. So I think that's what it's going to mind.
And then, who from here would notify us?
I upload them into the SMO system.
Yeah.
And once it's in the SMO system, well, you know that they're in there.
Yeah. Have you ever had... Oh,
yeah, sorry, because it's important to make sure that that organisation's in there, because if for some reason someone's working with children checkers come under review, if they're charged and there's a suspension or it's been revoked, a letter will go to the organisation that is listed on the application. Now, if that's the Anglican Diocese of Gippsland, we don't know unless you tell us.
Yeah, the real joy of me being here every Thursday and uploading this information is I can look at I worked with Cheryl Russell for a while, and I know who cannot apply for work with children's, and I think I've pulled up about four of them just by me being there and uploading it into the system, and I've alerted professional standards accordingly. So, yeah, it's... And then I can notify Marcella or anybody.
Yeah.
If you want me to list the people I do reach each week.
It's only if you get the letter to say that a working with children has been revoked or suspended.
Yes, okay.
So it's a letter that comes in. It's a different letter to the ones that you're normally scanning.
Yeah.
But it would come in to the diocese. So whoever opens the mail would need to be aware that as soon as that comes in, they need to alert us. We also run because a working with children card can be revoked, obviously, at any time. So we run, or the plan is once we've got all of the Gippsland working with children numbers in a correct format and we know who's working where, we can do a bulk check to verify on the Department of Justice website. And we like to do that fortnightly at least, because it keeps you up to date with anything. So as soon as something comes up, but the letter usually comes within a few days as well. So if we've got both checks being done, then it would be pretty hard for someone to get not notice that they're working with children. Yeah, yeah. The verification is the most up to date check of the...
Yeah, we've just had a question come through on the chat. What about VIT registration and working with children's check?
Okay, so VIT, you are working with children have now allowed VIT cards to be used in lieu of a working with children check on the condition that the person who has the VIT card links their VIT card with working with children check. So on the website, and I can add that information to the information that we send out to SMOs, on the Working with Children website, if you search VIT, it comes through and it'll tell you how the person does it, and the person whose VIT card use has to do it. It's not, you can't do it for them. So they log into their account, they put in their VIT number, and then list the organisations that they're volunteering for. So they would put the parish, and in that one we normally ask them to put Kiura down, because what happens is as soon as they've done that generates an email from the system which comes to us, and we can say, oh yeah, I've got Mary Briggs, she's got a VIT card but she's linked it with us, so we accept that in the clearance as a working with children card. If they just give a VIT card, then we'll ask people to link it, because if their VIT card was revoked, and we've spoken to VIT about this on a couple of occasions, they said that they wouldn't notify other bodies if their VIT registration was revoked for some reason. So I think they're linking in with working with children check sort of the way to, you know, for them to say, okay, well, we will allow, we'll feed through to Department of Justice and allow that to happen. Sorry, I just saw a question jump up there. And
I just came to know that she had a microphone's not working, so yes.
Oh, okay, that's all right.
feel free to put your questions in the chat.
Yeah, okay, that's okay. All right, so check if they've got a Working with Children card. If not, provide the link to obtain one. And then after that, we do everything else. So we get the safe ministry form. We check that it's all okay. We contact the two referees, usually by email. We email them out, and I bet a lot of you have done those checks already. It's about, I'd say, about 8 yes or no questions. It's quite simple. People fill that in, send it back to us. We add it to the application, and then we do... we check our files. We do a national register check, which is the Anglican National Register for people with offences on it. So we check all of those things, and then when everything's okay, then we provide a clearance, and then we send a certificate of clearance to the SMO for that position. The reason that there's always been a bit of discussion about, does the certificate go to the person or the parish? The issue that we saw with it was that if it went to the person and the person was in a parish, and then for some reason they weren't in that parish anymore and they went to another parish, they could still say, well, I've got my clearance certificate, so I'm okay. But it may well be because of something that occurred in the parish and they weren't reinstated into that role, or they were removed from a role. That, you know, they may not be suitable for that position anymore. So that's the reason why we send it to the SMO, so that you can keep it, and then you know that that person has been cleared. Yes, Vals?
Question about training. Does the clearance certificate include that the person has done the right training?
Well, I think that was the way that Gippsland wanted it, that they had to have done the training. So what we will do is liaise with Alice, because Alice has got a list of who's trained, done their training, and it's up to date. So I would say probably, and we'll work out whether when someone has got everything ready, we'll email Alice and say, we've got A, B, and C to clear. Have they done training?
Yep.
And then we'll know from there.
Okay,
so
thank you.
So those are little things, you know, that we're getting used to. We've started getting applications coming through this way, and this is the final steps really that we're getting into a process for, really.
What works?
Yeah. Okay, so the last one is your op shop volunteers. So the SMO has given a volunteer details form from the op shop coordinator, and that was another form that Alice uses in her parish, which we thought was great, because with the op shop workers, because they don't do the safe ministry form, there's nothing for them to send back to us to alert us that they're applying for a clearance. So with the volunteer details form, if that's emailed through to us, then we know straight away, okay, well, Joe Bloggs from this parish, he's applying for an op shop worker thing. Now we know what we need to do. So the SMO has given the volunteer details form from the op shop coordinator. The SMO just adds those details into the safe management online system, including the role type. It's good to have the role type on there, because we know that we're not waiting for a form for them. So the SMO emails the volunteer details form to us. So that's another way of us finding out the role. The SMO uploads the signed code of conduct to safety management online. So the code of conduct for church volunteers is attached to the safe ministry check, whereas because this is the only thing that needs to come back, and it has to be signed, the SMO just gets them to sign it, uploads it into SMO, and then we know it's there. It's a bit confusing, all the SMOs, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah. Okay, so the SMO provides a link for the applicant to obtain a police check if they haven't had one sort of from the last year or so. And the details of how to do the police check are exactly the same. It's a volunteer. They have to upload ID documents. We've got a few people around the diocese who might be able to help with that if there are any issues. And same, they help them to apply for a Working with Children check if they haven't got one already, and to add the working with children number to SMO, because we'll use that then. We'll go into SMO, we'll look for the code of conduct signed, we'll look for the working with children number, and we'll go and verify it online. And then we do the rest and send the clearance certificate to the safe ministry officer in the parish. So they're the processes. It's really sort of, you know, three or four things per role, I suppose, that are required. But I think if it's sort of a straightforward process, hopefully it'll be easier for people to do.
Can I make a comment about training again, please, Marcella?
Yes. Yeah.
So a lot of SMOs ask about what do you do about training for op shop volunteers because they don't need training. So on SM online,
coordinators do. They need the formal team.
On SM online, you put NA next to training.
I should have expanded. Sorry, Val. You need to mark it as complete, and then in the notes down the bottom, say training. Sorry, training.
Yeah. So just click on the link next to training, and that's going to change your colour to green. But in the little notes section, just put no training. Or something like that.
No training required.
Yeah, no training.
Due to op shop volunteer, etc.
Required. So training's a bit different. It isn't, training will be run out of the registry office, not Kiura, but all the training, when we get the certificates, etc., they'll all be uploaded to Kiura. So it'll all be on the system. But it's coming from two different places, which is
nice. Tracy has a question.
Yeah, thanks. I've never heard of the op shop form. We don't have an op shop. That's probably why. But I'm just curious, what is that form called that you're filling in for people who work in an op shop?
It's actually called Volunteer Church.
That's volunteer details.
Yeah, volunteer details. So we use the word volunteer to mean anyone who works in something that's run by the parish, but the person is not a member of the parish. So in an op shop, you would have coordinators who are part of the parish and they have to do the full safe church process. But for everybody else who isn't a member of your church but works for your church, they have to do this volunteer process. It's the same if they help out at, you know, meals that your church might run or other activities, but they're not members of your congregation. So we'll need to send another copy of that form.
Yeah, so what we're planning to do is after this meeting in the next couple of days, we're going to get all of the forms, all versions of the Safe Ministry Check, the under 18, over 18, the two forms that the volunteers fill in. There's a summary sheet of the process, similar to what the slides I've done today. There's also a more detailed one for people who like to know detail. Some like detail, some don't. So there's one of each. And then all of those things will be emailed out to the SMO so that you've got all the correct forms in the one space for your parish.
And they're all in these packs that you've had here today, but you're also going to send them electronically, aren't you?
They're going to be sent electronically, yeah.
So all the forms and the processes that you're talking about today are all in these packs that you have.
Yeah. Sorry, Val.
I was just going to say, one of the really good things about this new process is that we do get a clearance certificate at the end. That's never happened, and I think it's going to be a really good addition to the work that we do. I need to forewarn you that we're going, not straight away, but we're going to take some things off the website, particularly the Safe Ministry Check forms. So that the only way a person can get hold of that form is from the parish safe ministry officer. So once the Alice's form is filled in with the minister and the parish safe ministry officer, once that application form is filled in, then the safe ministry officer gives the applicant a copy of the safe ministry check. Now, we won't take that off the website straight away. We'll give you a bit of time, but I just thought I should forewarn you that that's going to happen.
Tracy's got another question.
Yep.
Yes, no, it's not another one. The other one wasn't really answered completely. So it seems to me, therefore, I asked about the op shop workers. It's a form that I've not seen, and you explained that this is a form for people who are volunteering in something that is run by the parish, but they are not a member of the church.
Yes.
So it seems to me now that there are three categories of people that we are screening. Number one are clergy and lay readers.
Yeah.
Although I thought ASLMs were also included in that category.
Yeah, they are. That's ASLM or lay reader is the term, interchangeable.
Okay, so we've got three categories. Number one is clergy, lay reader, and ASLM.
Yep,
that's one. Yep.
Number two is the group that you called authorized church worker, which are volunteers who are members of your parish.
Yes.
Okay. Why don't we call them volunteers? Like I'm just anticipating the next 50 times someone at my church says to me, this says it's for workers, and I have to say to them every time, oh, yeah, but that means volunteers as well. Why don't we put volunteers on the form?
Because we wanted to differentiate between that category and the people who volunteer who aren't part of your church. We certainly discussed this, Tracy, at the Safe Ministry Authority, but we wanted some way to distinguish between a church worker and a church volunteer. That's the reasoning behind that. I know it's a bit confusing.
Is a church worker in the Act?
Yes, and that's why I just. Tracy, it's just to make it consistent with the language in the Act, which talks about church workers being those with roles, position, and offices. So that includes someone on a morning tea roster, and even though they're volunteering, there have been instances where victims come into a church and they pick up the pew sheet and they see the name on the offender on a roster. And even if it's something as benign or innocuous as a flower arranging roster or a morning tea roster, a pure volunteer role, the person can say, given what has happened to me, how can the church give authority to this person to act as a volunteer?
No, I just like to say thanks to all the people who do the role of SMO and reiterate really what Val and Richard said earlier. It is a big job. It's something that initially it's going to take time to get it set up, but once it's set up, people just need to renew their position every 5 years or whatever it will be, 3 years, 5 years. So it's going to be hard at the start, but once it's set up, you'll know that your church is a safe place and you'll feel confident for your children and grandchildren and friends and whatever to come and know that they are worshipping in a safe place. So thanks for all the work and all the side of things.
Beautifully said, Marcella. On that note, good afternoon to all of you and thank you so much. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
See you, Julie.
See you later, Alice.